Welcome to LeaderCast, guys. Here we are, Friday again. We're here in downtown Tampa at the Attic Cafe. And, you know, we have a few people that we want to thank. Of course, PodFest Multimedia Expo, podfest.us, Chris Kremitos. Thank you very much for all the assistance when it comes to the podcasting. Now we have Richard McIntyre, McIntyreFirm.com. And I'm Anthony Kovic, and today's guest is Greg Cirio.
Yes, sir.
And founder of the People of Manufacturing. Well, Greg, thank you for being a guest today.
Thank you for having me.
And today's conversation is how to be connected to manufacturing. And tell us, what is the most important aspect of what your organization does into helping people get into the training of manufacturing? What should they look to and learn about your organization, how they can be part of manufacturing?
Well, the most important thing for anyone is to just understand that everyone plays a role in manufacturing. So our focus, if you're a job seeker, a person to get involved in manufacturing, is there's no set way of learning. It's lifelong learning. So if you're willing and able, there's a lot of different ways to get plugged in that I want to talk to you about on how, if you're that job seeker that you never really considered it before, but you want to explore those options in manufacturing, there's a ton of different options because no two manufacturers are exactly the same. So it's just, if you go into that understanding as a person, you can have the world is your oyster, because there's so many different jobs that you just need to know about.
Now, there's a misunderstanding when it comes to manufacturing in 2018, right?
Correct.
Compared to what people really think of manufacturing of the old days, like in the 50s and 60s, working in Detroit, working in companies that are, you know, there is a lot of automated systems in manufacturing now that the people are more in the skill level of manufacturing than it in the actual turning the nut.
Right. You know, it's like there's a huge misperception on what a machinist is, and it's confused with the word machine operator.
Yes.
So it's just driving that understanding that it's not the same as it used to be. Most plants that you walk into are clean, AC controlled, high tech, all the machinery is different and it has to be programmed. So you're having extremely high technical jobs that are going unfilled because there's that lack of understanding. It's the misperception that American society has as to what manufacturing even really is.
Yes, well, I mean, we think about it from the perspective of the jobs that left the United States over the decades for more, you know, migrant labor, manual labor, you know, sitting at the table, wherever they're doing whatever, and 20-hour days. That's what the perception of manufacturing may be to many people. But let's clarify that. You explained a little bit about it, but what are manufacturers looking for in today's modern employee to handle the manufacturing process?
What employers are really looking for is, at first and foremost, to be honest, there's that big of a gap.
Showing up on time, that is a skill.
It's kind of, you know, rudimentary to say that out loud, but it's so true. Because if you as a person, each manufacturer is so different, they're willing to train you, but if you're not willing to invest time in yourself, what makes you think that your employer, that manufacturer, is going to invest time in training you to get you to $25, $30, $40, $50 an hour throughout your career? Because it's really heavily weighed on a more technical side for programming and engineering. So those are two skill sets, but you have to couple those two skill sets with being able to learn and use your hands. And those are the two combinations of skill sets that are winning for someone that's got a successful career in manufacturing.
You know, one of the areas that, you know, doing things when it comes to learning this space and doing some research, and one of the things that I see when it comes to manufacturing is that our employers in manufacturing adding way too many skill requirements. When you see what the job skill set is, I mean, they put in the kitchen sink, they put in all this stuff, and for the most part, if a manufacturer is looking for an employee that is going to start at certain levels, they can't see themselves understanding what any of this stuff is.
Yeah.
So stop putting all this trash on the job, you know, requirements that you need this program and that program, this program, that program.
Yeah.
No one has 50 areas of programming skills. No one has,
you're absolutely,
you know,
right.
From, you know, if you didn't work in a 747 in the aeronautics section, because, you know, they may need that skill, that's a skill that they can train you. So avoid putting all these meaningless skills that really doesn't get that person in the door.
Yeah, and that's so true too. Here's the catch 22 of everything manufacturing is that manufacturers want to hire a skilled person with all these skills, like you were saying, that kitchen sink of skills.
If they had all those skills, they wouldn't be looking for those kind of jobs.
So
they would already be on the next position, like management.
Right. So it's really on that specific manufacturer that's making that specific widget. Because, I mean, if you look at everything in this room, like this painting, the wall, this table, at some point in time, it was an engineered drawing, right? That has a different process that's tied to how all of this is made. Not one is the same. They might be similar, but if you're a company with a specific niche of a product that you're growing and selling into the marketplace, you're going to have a niche workforce that you have to train on your specific machines. You can't expect for you to have a proprietary machine that's manufacturing someone, and then that just random person out in your community is just going to have that skill set for you to hire.
Exactly.
It just doesn't exist. It doesn't work that way.
I see it constantly where it makes me laugh because no one has those skills. No one has the skills that your company needs for a specific area of your business. They're not going to have the 50 items that you're looking for in total. They're going to be missing one thing. They're going to be missing this thing. They're going to be missing that thing. If you just put the skills that are most relevant to that position and the areas you're going to train, leave those out.
Yep.
Because they're going to look at it and say, okay, I don't qualify for this. I don't qualify for that.
Nobody does.
And you're looking for that employee, and you're wondering why people are not showing up for your jobs, because they don't qualify for all the stuff you put on that resume requirement.
You're absolutely right.
Stop putting that crap up, right?
Yeah, so you have that problem. You have that. So you have your specific things, but then you also have technology that advances daily. Like almost daily.
Exactly. So, and what do they do when a company brings in new technology? Guess what? Your employees don't know how to use that.
Nope. And that's where it's having your local partnership in the community to actually tell, because, you know, I talk to a lot of people about this, especially the skills gap in general. So if the biggest problem facing American manufacturing is this skills gap, that's where I've dissected it backwards in developing the standard, developing our company, studying and knowing manufacturing. What it really boils down to is, like you said, so if they're marketing this kitchen sink full of expertise,
exactly,
they're not getting what they need. So at the end of the day, is the real problem the skills gap? Because there's more than enough people. There's more than enough people that want a high-paying job.
Exactly.
So this is where we've came back and dissected it. It's really the lack of market exposure that each individual employer has in finding their right talent. That's really what it boils down to.
Because my opinion is they're missing the boat in collecting the proper employees for those positions by adding way too much skill requirements that are not necessarily even part of that job description, but they're adding it to make it look like if you have all this stuff, that they're looking for that perfect employee that has all that stuff. If that employee has that full range of skills, guess what? They're looking for a better job than that.
So to that same point, you're absolutely right. So if you go back to, say, like, let's go back to, you know, the 50s and 60s, or even like the 40s, or during the height of, you know, the military industrial complex, right? So if you have this open casting call, everyone come manufacture. So what happened is, over the years, it's changed. So it's not that, because, you know, NAFTA and offshoring and...
Yeah, of course.
It's not that... At maybe at one point in time, 30 years ago, that skill set, that gap was cheap labor overseas. that paradigm is completely shifted to today because those companies that are overseas, say China is getting more and more and more and more and more expensive. And I'm not talking because of a tariff right now. That's a whole nother conversation. I'm talking about they have perfected a process over a long period of time. So that becomes its own bucket of intellectual property. So the only way we can maintain our competitive edge as American manufacturing is to develop new processes. But to do that, you have to have the skill set of the people to do so.
Exactly. So as American manufacturing has developed most of the technology that is in China, people think that China is doing all these things. No, it's just labor that they're utilizing. American companies have gone there with the schematics, with the specs, built the technology, but using local labor. Where in the past, an American company can build a manufacturing plant, put in a casting call, and 5,000 people will show up. But in today's world, it's hard to build a manufacturing plant and move 5,000 people to your area that you need this because there's no housing. The local community will say, hey, we don't want 5,000 people showing up in our 2,000 people town because that's going to just blow up the town.
Well, to that same point, when was the last time that you heard a child, whenever you ask a kid, what do you want to do when you grow up? I want to be an astronaut. I want to be a firefighter. When was the last time you asked a child and they said, I want to build my own manufacturing plant? I want to start my own manufacturing business. You hear them say, I want to start a restaurant or this and that. But that alone is the problem. So if we're looking at new products, new companies that are forming, how do we inspire the youth that already adopts and they're born and bred into this technology to spark that curiosity for them to say, I can launch my own manufacturing company with a marketable skill? So if you don't have a skill to market yourself, so if the way to win in this, in anyone that you've talked to, a lot of what you'll hear is the, I want to build my personal brand.
Exactly.
Everyone's building a personal brand right now, selfie on Instagram, selfie on Snapchat. We're addressing an audience right now. This is the way of our world now.
Absolutely.
So how does the manufacturing demographic that is not adopted widespread the principles of Internet of Things, because it's a very closed door industry, how do you get a kid to understand what's going on inside that building to then spark that curiosity? Because that is the link, that is the key to solving that skills gap, is really going after our younger demographic that have that imagination that is not limited based on a jaded adult experience.
Exactly. Now, what is the registered apprenticeship program? Tell us about that.
A registered apprenticeship program is a program that's employer-driven, that's registered to the Department of Education, and it's also reviewed by the Department of Labor. So what my company is and what we did, we registered our own apprenticeship program to the state of Florida as a consortium of other manufacturers. So
very good.
I work with other manufacturers. We developed the curriculum. We developed the talent pipeline. We developed a career path for an apprentice, but it's also competency-based because especially if we're recruiting a younger demographic, they don't have the attention span to go to work for 4 years when most of them are college-bound. So with the registered apprenticeship program, it allows the manufacturer to say, this is what we want. This is we as the people of manufacturing, we as this manufacturer. This is the type of development pathway we want for the people coming into our workforce. And it's articulating that plan into one document and working with the state of Florida. It took about 2 years to register, as do most programs, because an apprenticeship program is one of the most complex education constructs that we have, because it includes several different areas of your community, like your community college, your universities, your local talent pools, your high schools. It requires all of that for an employer to run a successful apprenticeship program. So the way to say how I want my labor force, my labor demand, that's what a registered apprenticeship allows you as the manufacturer to do.
So basically, what you're connecting the manufacturing skills that the manufacturer requires, and then connecting it with education, schools, whether it's high school, state colleges, or colleges themselves.
Correct.
For people that may be interested in that specific path of that kind of manufacturing?
Correct. So we recruit the right person to refer that person to the manufacturer. But in order to do that, we have to define that, because there's also classroom instruction. Because there's a huge difference between, say, an internship, which most everyone knows what an internship is. It's either paid or unpaid. So you get that work experience, so then you can get a better job later on.
Or even at that specific location.
So what an apprenticeship program does is it takes that kitchen sink. I love that term, by the way.
Yeah, I mean, they just throw everything in there.
This is the
requirements. Like, it reads like this. And it's like...
Oh, no, you're taking a nap in the corner by the time you get to the end of it.
When you're looking at it, because it's funny, because I've been doing the research, looking for stuff, and this is what you see is, you know, 50, 60 items.
Oh, yeah.
You require this, you know, apprentice, you know, 5 years of this, 10 years of this, 9 years of this.
Yeah, and it just doesn't exist.
No one qualifies for that. Because if the person has that, guess what? They're doing something else.
And that's where everyone tries to put a Band-Aid on a bullet wound. You know, it's like the true way to actually make something real is it takes time to develop. So what the apprenticeship is just a development pathway with different checkpoints.
Yeah.
That each checkpoint, you're attaining a new skill that is comprised in that kitchen sink.
Because there's no one really, no matter what job you have, your skills are based on that specific company's way of doing things.
Correct.
You can have two exact companies and two different processes. Now you take, you know, for instance, let's say fast food industry. There are several companies that do the exact same thing.
Exact.
But guess what? They have different technology, different procedures, different functionality. So even if you worked in one and you were the best at it, you can walk into the next company and you have to be retrained, because
every time.
You know means nothing to them.
Yep.
Because the button you're normally pressing is not the same button in the next company. So whether it's the fryer, whether it's the burger machine, all the functionality of that company is completely different. So when you're looking at hiring and you're putting all these things based on your company, people that don't work for you ain't going to have those things.
No, and that's where it's like, so identifying the different, you know, this is where the success of the apprenticeship comes in is.
And so how does that work when it comes to the apprenticeship program? What are they looking for in the training processes? Because manufacturing is not the same from one company to the next.
No, and it's what I looked for in studying and knowing what jobs are out there is the common transferable skills.
Yeah.
So if you know how to swing a hammer, if you know, you know, an adjustable wrench, you know how to tighten stuff or use a torque wrench, those are all applicable. So finding which areas are being talent developed through either the shop classes in school or different trade programs and or just what they learned. So then sectoring it out. So most of it's centered around a CNC machine.
Yes, the CNC. Tell them what the CNC machine is.
So CNC stands for Computer Numeric Control. So it's back in the old days, everything was manual, pulleys and cranks. You're making precision parts by hand and dialing and then doing the math by hand. So what a CNC does is it takes the point of your tool, if it's a mill, and then it tells your machine where your tool should travel, and that's done through a process called CAM, computer-aided manufacturing or machining. So that skill of learning the program and the skill of understanding the tooling application, that is the description of what a machinist is.
Yeah, very good. So what does American manufacturing, you know, different than, you know, like offshoring? I mean, now American manufacturing is pulling back from their offshore processes. You know, Apple is brought in, what, $350 billion due to primarily President Trump convincing companies that, hey, you need to start bringing this money back to the United States and retooling here, or else you're going to have a higher barrier of bringing in your products into the United States.
Yeah, and that's, so when Trump got in office, it did kind of expedite things, but there was already a big movement going on, because if you look at what's going on with manufacturing, they're kind of on their own. it's very similar to the world of IT in finding a way to develop. You're not getting what you need from the school system, so you were kind of on your own to develop your own talent anyway. So what manufacturers have had to do to compete with offshore pricing is develop better processes. So one of my favorite examples that where manufacturing changed the game for other companies.
Tell us.
Is say, you know what a Yeti cooler is?
Yes.
So then all of a sudden you see that patent may have expired and whatever happened, you see Arctic pop up, right? So automated processes were developed because of manufacturing and the need to automate. So because there wasn't people showing up to work, the need to automate became prevalent. So that's a misconception in itself, but that automated process allowed for someone like an Arctic to build a better supply chain and then start dominating the market because they started adopting automated that were developed in manufacturing. So those processes and processes that are developed through different types of process engineering, it was all engineered to combat the low offshore pricing. So all we did is just make a better mousetrap.
Well, it's coming up with, you know, the process. Currently, the strawberry picking in Florida has become a big problem with not enough people able to pick strawberries.
Oh, yeah.
So they've gotten together as a group and came up with a way to build a system that would actually pick the strawberries. You know, it uses a lot of high-tech technology, cameras all over the place, with fingers to be able to pluck the correct strawberry. It's not completely completed at this point. It's still in the process.
It'll be there quick.
It's coming faster than people think, because as Americans don't want to do, you know, the manual labor like that, what American manufacturing is going to do is come up with systems to make that automated.
Oh, yeah.
Instead of having people picking, now you have people managing the technology that picks it.
So let's talk about how that is exactly it. So that is the very definition of economic development.
Exactly.
So if you look at manufacturing as a whole, they have the largest economic development multiplier. So I think it's for every one job in manufacturing, it's like 2.93, don't quote me on that, but it's pretty close, of jobs that are outside of the industry, higher than any other trade, any other business. So if you look at an example like that, if you have, say, a person going to the strawberry fields to pick, I grew up in Plant City, off of Thanonasassa, in the middle of them. I was one of those kids that picked those strawberries. I hated it back then. I would never go back into it now, but I guarantee you, if I had an opportunity to go work on a robot that's picking strawberries, yeah, that's way more alluring. So you're getting a higher dollar per hour, higher quality of employee, and you're not having as many. So if you have someone that's making $8 an hour versus someone making 25 to 30, that economic impact, that gas station down the road is now being monetized on more. That person is now going to live a higher quality of living because they joined a trade and they learned it. So then that economic multiplier that comes thereafter, they're growing the economy by offering these higher wage jobs.
Now, one of the things that's happening is more micromanufacturing.
Mm-hmm.
With today's smaller robots, not the big ones that cost $1 million a piece, but the smaller ones that's coming out of the Boston, you know, manufacturing market.
Boston Scientific.
Exactly, MIT, where they're making robots that don't require actual programming, where you can have a small robot the size of this little table, and by just taking its arm, putting it in position, hitting the processes of actually making the robot understand by just taking the robot through the process, it will then repeat that cycle, pick up the item, and do the same thing over and over again. So a small place, maybe 2,000-3,000 square feet, can have 4 or 5 robots doing a 24-hour job with maybe 2 or 3 technicians paying, you know, watching the robots and doing the more complex labor and taking out the more menial labor forces that really no one wants to do repetitively for a, you know, until they go to retirement.
Yeah, and that's the curb. So my kids, you know, in 10, 20 years, that's going to be a higher demand job, because right now, if the skills gap to get us to that point, so if a machinist is the highly skilled job that's being recruited right now, the role that robotics plays in manufacturing, that machine learning, a lot of it was heavily invested into because of necessity, because of that skills gap.
Yes.
So to your point, the micro manufacturing, and this kind of is where I would love to talk to the youth, and this is how I talk to the youth.
Yeah, tell them. Like.
So if you're a young person, you know, especially in this day and age where you were born knowing how to use a cell phone, it's very attainable for you to launch your own company, work for yourself, live for your own purpose, building your own inventions, because of how technology changed. It made it more accessible to more and more people. So it's not the mega factories, it's not your Amazons that have 100,000. You can get started by getting, you know, $1,000 a year for software to learn how to design your own products, and then, you know, maybe a $3,000 3D printer, and then you can do it right in your garage.
The 3D printer. Explain the 3D printer opportunities that are now coming together, where small parts can be made by small companies in their garage,
yeah,
connected to a larger company, where you're shipping just that small part.
Well, 3D printing in the world of manufacturing, if you're looking at it from a commercial use standpoint, it's only now starting to be adopted. In the industry, it's not really 3D printing, it's additive manufacturing. That's the real world if you're going to talk about it being commercially used.
Okay.
So what happened with additive manufacturing, it runs on the same playing field. So the tip of that part that's printing is a coordinate plane, uh-huh, just like a CNC machine, just like any other robotics, because a robotic arm, it's standing in space. That space is programmed to be on a coordinate plane. So
exactly.
With 3D printing, the biggest hurdle for commercial use was, if you're looking at something like, say, we're making a mold to make a water bottle, that material that you're machining, that hardened steel, it's got a material specification on it, and you know that material composition. So one of the biggest hurdles that's being leaped right now, and you're going to see more and more commercial use of additive manufacturing because of this, is that material composition that's being made as it's making is now being able to be defined by people, like, because you don't, if you're flying a plane, you want that plane to be made exactly how it's supposed to be made.
Exactly.
You want to know that the materials on that plane, the titaniums and composites, are exactly what they say it is. Otherwise, your plane's falling out of the sky.
Yeah, we don't want
so that. So if you have a 3D printer, you don't really know the composition of it consistently unless now that standard is changing. That was the biggest hurdle. So now you can start seeing more and more 3D printing. So it's also engineered a little bit differently, because you're... Instead of starting with a block of metal and removing that metal to have your finished manufactured part, you are now adding material, so you have to kind of engineer it in reverse.
Exactly.
Which is why because additive manufacturing is a big part of our program, because we know that is the future. That's also a hole in education right now, because there's no real standard way of learning 3D printing. It's kind of fragmented, just like a lot of other places, like in the IT sector. And
now the important factor in that is the ability to actually make your prototype and run your tests, where if I had the idea of making this mouse,
yes,
you know, I could 3D print it many times, get it to some kind of a workmanship that is functional,
yep,
and then take it to a manufacturer to mass produce it, where before,
correct,
you know, to make a mold of this and test it out and work with a designer, you're talking $50,000, $60,000, $100,000 to get it to a design, to a finished designable, yep, product. That's before you start making item number one.
Yeah, and that's why our focus is more on engineering, so we have more engineers out there that also know, because, so to your same point, you're absolutely right. If I wanted to make this widget, the traditional way of, all right, we have to engineer it out, we have to build the fixtures, and we have to set it up, we have to make the mold, you know, it's a several-month process, whereas if you have a completed design, you can 3D print it to get your form, fit, function to see if your prototype works. So you're taking products to market like that. versus several months of waiting. Or if you're a new company, a new startup that wants to go into the manufacturing sector, that's why there's not many people going, because of that cost.
Exactly.
So the all that technology did, and additive and 3D printing, it just made it more accessible for people to make their own products and launch a company in today's day and age.
Now, how does your registered apprenticeship program, completely differ from, or does it, actually accommodate, let's say, high school and college?
Yes.
In comparison, so if they're out there doing the normal education process and learning manufacturing and the apprenticeship program, how does your program work differently or better, or how it does?
It works drastically differently because it's competency based and employer driven.
So the employer-driven part is the key, right?
That is always the key, because the employers are the ones that employ the employee to drive that economic growth.
How quickly, because it's employer-driven, and it's employer-driven up to today's date, where some education programs are based on years past technology and knowledge and processes. Is that the real difference?
I
just want to clarify that, the difference between it's employer-driven today compared to education of yesterday.
Exactly. So with this entire construct being to edify the employer because we developed it, the employer gets to deem how skilled that person is, because the employers that I'm working with are investing in their workforce. They're investing in training to make sure that they have the skill set, because they know it's going to do their ROI.
When you say they're investing in the training, are they participating in training the students as well?
Yes. So there's the pre-apprenticeship that's being developed, but what I do for my biggest client right now is a company called Sonny's, the car wash manufacturer. They're in Fort Lauderdale, Broward.
Uh-huh.
So right now they employ 217 people, of which 30 of them are in the shop floor area. So they have, I think, 12 CNC machines in one area, 4 robotic arms, and they're expanding. So they've always had a social responsibility to the community, so they've always had kids that go through it's called a FIRST Robotics program in high school, and they pull their talent from there, and then their engineers, they either paid for them to go to college, some of them are degreed engineers from UCF, or that's what they contracted my company to do, is I'm building a custom curriculum around their specific machinery to feed their specific workforce. So as they participate on the standard, now it's registered to the state, so now we as a partnership can also pursue different types of grant subsidies to offset that cost of training.
Interesting. So are you looking for students, or are you looking for manufacturers? What are you looking for first?
Currently, right now, I'm looking for more manufacturers to look at the standard and then participate in the standard. There's no cost to be on the standard.
Oh, wow.
Because it would allow you the autonomy that you need as the employer to go get the rest of the supports from your community, from your local career source and workforce boards, from your local high schools and community colleges, and that's what this standard allows them to do. So the cost of training and that cost that's incurred by having an apprentice, because by the eyes of the state, an apprentice should know 50% of what their counterpart that's an expert that knows, or their journey worker. So they also understand that what takes a journey worker an hour to do, they also know that it's going to take that apprentice 2 to 3 hours to do. So there's a cost that's associated with that to the manufacturer, which is why it's essential to have a registered program, so you can have access to all the supports that's in your community through the different types of grants and subsidies that might be specific for your demographic, because every geographical area has a different talent pool. You know, what South St. Pete looks like is drastically different than, say, what North Gainesville looks like. So it's just understanding your community and the demographic that you're hiring, so that you can invest back in your workforce, because it's going to take a different level of investment depending where you are geographically.
Now, how can people get in touch with you for if they're a manufacturer?
Manufacturers, I encourage to first check out our website, because we have we focus really hard on content media to explain the different corners of what we do, so the involvement with your nonprofits. So I would say go to www.thepeopleofmanufacturing.com. And you can contact me directly by emailing info@tpomfg.com. It's an acronym for the people of manufacturing.
It'll be also on the page as well, but is there a phone number that that you want to give out at this time that they can contact you?
Yeah, my cell currently is 813-321-9569, and we're looking for about a dozen manufacturing employers locally, maybe in the Central Florida area or in the Broward County area, that are looking to adopt the standard.
So Central Florida meaning from?
South Florida, West Broward.
West Coast, the East Coast, Central Florida.
Yeah, I'm registered here in the Tampa Bay area in Broward County, but I can operate statewide. So if you're a manufacturer in the state of Florida, you can have access to our standard.
Oh, okay.
And then inside the standard, it lays out the pathway that you would need to go to as the employer on what your apprentice can accept, the pay wages. You know, you would get a copy of the standard that's registered to the state, so you can kind of see what your future workforce would go through. And then you can start calculating how much that you're able to invest in your workforce, and then we can help you invest that and help you find the different grant subsidies.
So when you say, compared to an employee who's been working that specific job, a new employee or apprentice will take maybe two or three times longer to fill that same work hour schedule if he was working alone. So every day or every week, that employee will take what takes maybe an hour to do something by a existing skilled employee. Every month, that skill set rises to the level to where they get to becoming an expert. Is that correct?
And that's exactly it. Because some people catch on quicker than others.
Exactly.
You know, so that's why it was so important to have competency-based. Because one example, we have our first apprentice actually here in Odessa. He started, and he's been there 2 weeks since the standard went live. And he came from FIRST Robotics, so he already understood how to make CAD models. So within 2 weeks, he's already making CAD models because he was that advanced, because we mentored him ahead of time, because I knew that employer's needs. So he's immediately a value-adding employee. So what he learned ahead of time in high school through the FIRST Robotics and robotics clubs and classes immediately added value, so he got to start at a higher wage and a higher competency, because that's where his competency level is.
Ah, so the better the skill set, even though his skill set was in the area of what the company was needing, but not specifically the item that he was supposed to be, that he was going to be working on.
Exactly. So he had those transferable skills that I knew as the registered apprenticeship program and the coordinator of that program, I knew that it would add immediate value to this specific employer. So this is why it's so important as a manufacturer to get plugged into your community, so you can start doing a lot of this work, mentoring them before they even get to you, so it can add value to you almost immediately.
So the job skills that you have, three sheets of, the more you apprentice people, the more of those skills on this sheet they will have.
Exactly.
And the less time it will take for them to actually get to that level of being an expert on that particular skill set for that position.
Correct. It's capitalism at work with social responsibility.
Now, when it comes to for those who want to be part of the training in the manufacturing side, what do they have to deal with or learn when it comes to their day-to-day processes as an apprenticeship with registered manufacturing?
So the registered apprenticeship has a committee.
Yeah, right.
So we review the apprentice before they come on board.
So you handle all those things so someone as a wannabe employee in manufacturing signs up with you guys, you then take them through what? Take us through that.
So if a manufacturer signs up with us, we'll assess the business. It usually takes no longer than a day. We'd come visit, see what the needs are, see where the gaps are, and then we have partnerships with several nonprofits that are already developing talent. I would pick which one is the best for them. So, a DOD contractor can't necessarily hire an ex-offender or someone that went to prison. So that might not be a good fit. But someone else down the road that would hire, they have a social responsibility, they cater to that demographic, they can hire someone from there. Meanwhile, the nonprofit is helping that talent pool that's coming to them develop, so I can partner them so they have a continual feed of apprentices in the future.
So now, new people wanting to apprentice, you're able to connect them with companies yep. that you've figured, that you've learned their processes,
correct.
Came up with it, what their talent pool requires, and then you take people that have trained through some of your outlets, whether it's high school, college, you know,
correct.
Whatever, and you're able to at least combine them with the basics of what they can, what they're going to be, you know, manufacturing. So at least you'll know yep. what talents they have to plug them in, even though they may not have all the talents for that company.
Correct. So they might just have the lettuce and tomato from the kitchen sink, and
yeah,
then
yeah.
It's up to us, and that's why we have such strong partnerships with the nonprofit. So we can tell that nonprofit what the manufacturer is looking for, and then they can develop that talent before they even get there. So knowing that this is scaling in the future, us having the manufacturers on the standard, we can start scouting and pulling from the partnerships we already have, because we have plenty of people that we have amped up about a potential career in manufacturing that are already learning right now using different online learning platforms, which is ultimately where we will be by the end of the year. Because we're going to be building a portal on the website, so you can have, if you're a nonprofit, this is how you can be involved in developing talent. If you're a manufacturer, this is how you can be involved with your nonprofit, so you never have that gap ever again, because as you're developing talent on your plant floor, you're teaching that apprentice to then teach the next one behind him. So like my favorite nonprofit is both PERC, which is Pinellas Ex-Offender Rehabilitation Coalition.
Very good.
They're out of St. Pete, Tarpon, Clearwater. They help people with successful reentry. So the people that go to their program is voluntary. So I know if I refer anyone from their demographic for a job, they're hungry. Because anyone that I place into a job, I want them just as hungry for manufacturing as I am. So they... an opportunity for someone that grew up in, you know, like say a CRA in South St. Pete, Community Revitalization Area. $15 an hour to start, to learn, plus you get some college credit towards the end, and then you're making $20+ an hour. That is life altering.
Absolutely.
So then, you know, if you're pulling from, say, the high school demographic, which is FIRST Robotics, anyone can set up a FIRST Robotics team, but these teams are simulated business unit full of teens that work together in engineering a robot, building a robot, and then competing with the robot. So they have all these transferable skills, so that maybe they're not as hungry as someone that is looking for a fresh start in life, but they have these transferable skills, and they've been told about college repeatedly. So picking the right one out of those groups to say, have you thought of a career in manufacturing? Usually my answer is no, because they're off to some sort of college or somewhere, and then that's when I explain to them what the program is, and it allows for an opportunity like the apprentice in Odessa. A week in, he's using his knowledge that he's gained over the last 5 years of competing robotics, immediately adds value.
Now when it comes to the entrepreneurs in the area, how can they play a role in manufacturing?
The role that entrepreneurs play is how we're going to launch Industry 4.0. So those products, so a lot of entrepreneurs, they have that grit. They usually make stuff happen.
Exactly.
The real ones anyway. So if you have an entrepreneur with a marketable skill, that's all I started off as. I knew how to machine stuff. Then I marketed that. So I was able to build a company for myself off of my marketable skill.
Nice.
So by going through this program, part of what the apprentice is going to learn is the business aspect and ROI of what they're doing for that business in the event they want to launch their own manufacturing business. And then the current, if say I want to build a whatever widget, we'll go back to your mouse. I have this revolutionary mouse that I want to develop. It's the best mouse on earth, period. You can then utilize the Internet of Things and the engineering software to teach yourself how to engineer instead of paying an engineer that you don't know if you're going to get the right result or not. Then you can go, and then instead of paying 50 grand for your mold, you can just go ahead and buy three 3D printers for 9 grand, or just buy one and start 3D printing it, because you can market your journey along the way as an entrepreneur of you learning how to make your own product, because that alone is a story right now that you can market.
Now, your online platform, you touched on it a little bit earlier, but I want to get into a little bit more depth into it. What will people access on your online platform, and is that available now to the public?
Not right now, but by the end of the year we will be, because that's what we're doing for Sunnies. So we're building a custom curriculum for them. Knowing that the demand for different parts is different on any given day, that apprentice might have a different part next week. So I wanted that curriculum to be so modular that the apprentice can pull out their phone, use their curriculum on their phone to cater to whatever it is they're learning. So we're going to be very video-centric because we're in a visual world. So that's why we're heavy on right now we're capturing content. So the more content, we have close to 10,000 pictures, several terabyte of videos of just manufacturing processes that we're building an online database, because it's up to that apprentice. That apprentice is also going to be self-auditing himself and sending us content, and then that's how we can view their progress through that interface that's going to be on there. So by the end of the year, we'll launch that, and that there's... But it's going to be once we're finished building out the actual courseware, which is going to be a Sunny's name. So they're the early adopter. They have an awesome story, and we're going to be marketing that together. So as it progresses, the apprentice will have access on their phone for whatever we build, with a video of what they learned with us. So it's going to be, we're teaching people how to teach themselves, along with different partners. One of my favorite partners, and Tony Glockler, I'm going to send this to you. If you go to solidprofessor.com, he's got an amazing online learning platform that we're also going to be, we're buying licenses for each apprentice for them to learn very similar, but the engineering side of manufacturing. So if you go to just a principle like that, knowing that the internet is how everyone's going to win in the future, that's the way we have to go with our curriculum and standards. So these are all different tools that are going to be in a toolbox for the manufacturers that participate in our standard.
Now, when it comes to communities, I mean, every community in the United States is its own little ecosystem. And there are lots of communities that say, we don't have manufacturing, we don't have this kind of stuff, because manufacturers are in big cities, are in areas that
they
are not necessarily
everywhere.
You know, but as 4.0 becomes available, manufacturing 4.0, yep, where a small room and two micro robots is a manufacturer now. Tell us, what can communities do to become part, and what should they be doing?
Well, definitely if you're in a community just as a whole, especially say like a rural community. I did a lot of traveling, and there's that one manufacturing plant. So like a good example is Perry, Florida. If anything were to happen to that Georgia Pacific mill and or Chemring, two large plants that are out there, that would pretty much decimate the economy of that town.
And everybody between unemployment, mortgages, everything.
Oh my
pretty
gosh,
much.
Yeah. It's and then that's another, just in the state of Florida alone, there's over 17,000 manufacturers. Because manufacturing is small business, but no one ever knows what's in these four walls.
Yeah.
Because they're shoved in industrial parks that are tucked away behind,
that people never travel to.
And it's something that, and again, this kind of goes back to the problem of manufacturing's needing to market themselves better, to let the community know that they're there. So if you're in a community, especially in the state of Florida, I guarantee you there's at least 24 manufacturers in that city. Just because manufacturing is small business, and I believe it's 80 to 90% or so. I don't know. I'll send you afterwards as a follow-up, just because I want to remember. But it's 80 to 90% of manufacturing is small business. It's those 2 to 20 million dollar companies. That is manufacturing. So as a community, you should just know. If you're in any community, just know manufacturing is right around the corner anywhere.
And we're not thinking about, most people think of manufacturing as Ford, General Motors, the big, thousands and thousands of employees. Manufacturing today could be, a dozen employees.
Yep.
In a small leased space.
And that's the manufacturing of the future. If you look at things that win, Amazon, they're dominating the marketplace because they control the supply chain. So if you look at manufacturing of the future and you look at, you know, what we do as a company is helping develop that future supply chain of manufacturers, it's going to be small business and it's going to be plants that are 10 to 20,000 square feet.
Well, we're pretty much almost at the end of the show. And I just wanted to make sure that there's nothing here that I left out that is vital to people understanding about what you guys do,
yeah,
how to connect with you, whatever. Is there anything that we should know that I missed when it comes to, you know, people manufacturing?
No, we covered most of it. I just want to encourage anyone on earth to just know that wherever you walk, wherever you look at it, there's something that's been manufactured. And you as a consumer should know that there's a process that goes behind it and huge opportunity. So just being aware of what manufacturing really is still helps what we're doing, because that's what we're ultimately trying to do, is change that stigma to bridge that skills gap to better our community and let the economy thrive.
Because today's manufacturing is not your father's manufacturing.
It's not your father's manufacturing.
It's not your father's old car. It's totally modern. And a whole different,
it's
a whole different business, a whole different lifestyle.
Yep. Yeah, picture, you know, in 10 years from now, my kid's probably not going to need a driver's license. McDonald's are probably going to be automated. So all of these different types of innovation started with manufacturing having to innovate it out of necessity.
Exactly. Well, Greg Zero, founder of The People Manufacturing,
PeopleManufacturing.com.
Yeah, people of. Okay, it's like so tight. It's all written, all one word. PeopleOfManufacturing.com is the website.
Correct.
And from there, they can get in touch with your company and learn more about.
And we're on Facebook and the different socials. So the Facebook is definitely probably the best way to get a hold of us too.
Is it? What's the actual tagline on? What's the address? What they should look for?
At the People of Manufacturing.
At the People of Manufacturing. Is it the at symbol or the AT?
It's the at symbol.
The at symbol. Very good. Well, Greg, thank you again for being part of LeaderCast, and
I appreciate you having me.
We're here live. Downtown Tampa, 500 East Kennedy at the Attic. And of course, we want to thank attorney Richard McIntyre, McIntyreFirm.com, and of course, PodFest Multimedia Expo. Visit podfest.us for more information on next year's conference. It's going to explode your access to the world via podcasting. So we'll see you. I'm Anthony Kovic with LeaderCast, and we'll see you next Friday.